to this meeting of cabinet. I think, first of all, declare, just register Stuart Whittingham's apologies. Stuart's taking a rest at the moment, a holiday, so we'll do that. Item one is members' code of conduct, declaration of interest. Do any members wish to declare any interests? I will certainly register my interest or an interest in item five, the designation of a neighbourhood forum and neighbourhood planning area for Birkenhead and Tranmere. I'm a member of the Birkenhead and Tranmere Neighbourhood Forum, and therefore I'll be declaring that as an interest. I'll be leaving the room, won't take any part in the decision, I'll be handing over to my deputy and happen to chair the cabinet for that meeting. I also probably need to certainly declare that I'm a director of the Chamber of Commerce, who also mentioned you in that report as well. But the main interest is the forum, so if I could register that. Any other members wish to declare interest, Adrian?
I think I should declare that I'm closely associated with the Children's Centre in St. Paul's Road, but not in what I would regard to be a prejudicial way.
Any more for anyone? Okay, if not, we'll go to the first item, which is the capital monitoring report. I think this report is for us to note, but can I just make a few comments? I mean, first of all, it's pleasing to read the capital projects that are taking place, which will improve facilities around the borough. So, page four, the work that's going on to upgrade our schools through primary schools. I think it's great that on page five we are investing in our leisure estate, and the phase one of West Kirby Concourse is complete and open, the new street's open. And also, I'm particularly pleased in paragraph 3.8 about the forthcoming LED lighting scheme, which I think will be very welcome in the borough and improve our street lighting services. So, and also the new housing mentioned in the paragraph 3.9, which is obviously welcome as well. So some really great projects going on there. I think just if I could just turn straight to the recommendations in paragraph 18. So we're being asked to note that spend at monthly is 7.3 million, with a quarter of the financial year gone. We're being asked to agree and refer to council the revised capital programme of 61.5 million in table one, and that the capital monitoring report be presented to cabinet at the end of each quarter in line with our performance management monitoring arrangements. So those recommendations. Anybody got any questions, comments? So can we agree those recommendations?
Absolutely.
Thank you very much. So that takes us on to item three, the revenue monitoring report. And clearly, we've got some challenges in our revenue monitoring, in the sense that we have, as it says in paragraph 1.1, at the moment a small overspend of 2.9 million, but I'm pleased to see in the report that there are measures in place to address this. I think it's not been helped, it's mentioned in a couple of places in this report, by the government's in-year cut to our public health budget of some 2.4 million. I think we all know what the trajectory is for public spending, but I think in-service cuts are particularly difficult to manage because we've already set our budget, agreed contracts, made commitments, and then to come along, literally 3 months into the year and impose, and it is an imposition, a 2.4 million cut in a hugely important area for us, public health. It does make it impossible to manage budgets. When you have an in-year cut. So, I mean, I've written to the Secretary of State for Health, putting forward our sort of disgust really at something like that. we're not going to get any change, in their view, but we need to register our opposition when things like that happen. And I have to say I'm concerned that in the forthcoming spending review, we may well get more in-year public spending cuts to deal with, which, as I say, makes planning almost impossible. Having said all that, I think the officers are doing the best job they can to manage a very difficult budget situation. We know that we've still got, on top of the in-year service cuts, we've still got 70 million to save over the next 3 years. And the Local Government Association annual conference, which George Davis and I attended a few weeks ago in Harrogate, we were sort of told that we should plan for 5% cuts, at least 5% cuts, on top of what we've already got in the budget. So it's going to be a difficult year, but I think, as we said in our 2020 plan, we need to work even more creatively and with our partners to make sure that we get the best value for every pound that we spend, not just in the rural council budget, but the public sector budget generally. So I'm really just going to again direct you to the recommendations in paragraph 17 of this report, that the revenue budget 15-16 be amended to reflect the reprofiling of the delivering savings programme, that officers identify actions to reduce the projected overspend of 2.9 million, which I believe we're well on track to do that. And then finally, that the financial monitoring report be presented to Cabinet at the end of each quarter, a bit like the capital report. And I think we need a fourth recommendation, that this monitoring report needs to be referred to Council for the revenue budget 15-16 as amended be referred to Council. Okay, so can we bring those recommendations? Okay, thank you. Right, that takes us then to item 4, the early years and children centres. Tony Smith, to introduce this, please, Tony.
Okay, thanks, Chair. This particular report responds to the review of early years and children's centres and sets out changes required to modernise the service and make it compliant with the required national standards and legislative framework. It also responds to the need to make savings of 1.5 million and to target the available resources in a way which is most likely to improve children's readiness for school. Can I just say, though, just add to that our budget, the early intervention budget, over the last sort of 5 years has been reduced from 10 million to 3.5 million. So previously the early intervention grant was ring-fenced, but it's not ring-fenced now. So that's a little bit of the background. The consultation which took place, the process which took place between the 16th of February and the 27th of March 2015, 934 people responded to the consultation questionnaire, and over 300 people, that was including service users, residents and other stakeholders, attended consultation events. Two petitions were also received, one from Wallasey with 375 signatures, one from Earl West with 675 signatures. Both were opposing the proposed changes. The feedback has been considered as part of the consultation process. Consultation feedback was received in respect of targeting the offer, partners working together through children's centres, delivering services through an outreach model, developing a hub and satellite model, and views about the overall impact of the proposals. So taking account of the consultation findings, this report recommends a reduction from the proposed 4 hubs to 3, with one main hub serving South and West Wirral, and an increase in satellites from 4 to 6. This is to increase local access points for delivery and reduce the amount of administrative overheads. In South Wirral, it is proposed that it is a move from Eastern to Bromborough. While this report recommends a reduction in designated children's centres, it does not propose the closure of any children's centre buildings. It is proposed that the revised approach is adopted to deploying resources which is most likely to reach the most disadvantaged children in the world. This will be done through the application of a balanced funding formula based on need and the use of proven tools and models. This will result in some settings experiencing a significant reduction in council funding. However, in each instance, work will be undertaken through advisory boards and the school governing bodies to jointly plan how to mitigate the impact of these changes on children and families. These changes will come into effect in early 2016. This report largely focuses on the council's resources and the reconfiguration of council services used to meet the needs of children and their families pre-birth through to 5 years of age. However, stated in the review and through consultation feedback, services and support provided to our youngest children must in future be developed and delivered through greater integration with partners, including parents and families. There is significant money and resources invested across the world in our youngest children and their families. This includes, for example, the 2, 3, and 4-year-old offer, some of which is delivered through schools, health visiting and midwifery services, private and voluntary sector spend, services arranged, delivered and directly purchased by parents, in addition to the council's spend. Determining how this money and these resources are effectively invested to ensure the best outcomes for children and families will form the next steps to implement the council plan, a vision for 2020. The implementation of the review is to provide a secure and stable platform from which to deliver an ambitious joint plan to ensure children in the world have the best start in life, evidenced by them being ready for school. Just like to add to that very briefly, Chair, that on the 13th of July, Chief Inspector Schools, Michael Wilshaw, produced his annual report on early years. And the gist of that report was, and I think, you know, it indicates that we are on the right lines, he said, what is encouraging that outcomes for children from disadvantaged backgrounds are rising in line with their peers. There is no sign of the gap narrowing in any substantial way. So we're not different from any other local authorities, but we are tackling that particular problem. And to just give you some quick figures, of the 159,000, I think it is, children of 2-year-olds who should be able to access the free care for 2-year-olds, only something like 50% are actually accessing that. So, you know, we have got to go out and reach those children and ensure that, you know, we are getting them into settings as early as possible. And, you know, from next year, 2016, HMI will be looking at local authorities and how, and actually ranking local authorities and how well they are actually doing that job. So the whole gist of this report is trying to ensure that the needs of children in the most disadvantaged areas are being met. We want children at the end of the reception year, when we have the early years foundation state testing, we want them to have ensure that all the children are at the expected level. Can I make three recommendations, Chair? The first is that the Cabinet notes the consultation process detailed within this report and thanks rural residents, staff and other stakeholders for their input. 2, the Cabinet notes the detailed consultation findings provided in the report and associated Appendix 1. Thirdly, that Cabinet approves the revised delivery model outlined in this report and agrees to its implementation, including taking the required steps to make the necessary workforce changes and redefining the use of process. That's the report.
Thanks, Sully. I mean, just to add to that, I mean, I think that thing that you quoted right at the start, the government cut in the early years grants, I think from 7-10
10 million
to 3 is is a pretty devastating kind of cut, really, in an essential, a vital service. And I think, again, it just underlines the unfairness, really, the way the government has distributed funding, you know, in an area like rural with areas of deprivation. To have to take that kind of cut is really really difficult to deal with. But I think, again, Tony, I mean, this is about working creatively, even though we're up against it in terms of government cuts. And I think the model is that you've outlined is, I think, is a good way forward. And I think also, for example, I think the use of the outreach team means that it can be a lot more flexible. They don't need to be necessarily based in a particular building. It could be a community centre, it could be somebody's home. And I think that's the way we've got to be much more flexible in terms of providing services. And I think, again, because of the cuts that we're having to deal with, I think it's quite right that we focus on those children who live in high areas of high deprivation, which I think this report is doing. And then finally, I think, as you said, and this is very much in line with the 2020 plan, it's about greater integration with our partners to deliver these vital early years services. So it's been a difficult process, I do get that, but I think, you know, the circumstances against the background of that very difficult funding situation, it's quite an imaginative way forward to make sure that we keep the services that we're providing going. Those frontline services are essential, and I think this is a good outcome to a difficult process. So, unless there are any other comments, Adrian, you want to say something?
Well, in a sense, Chair, I just want to echo some of your comments. When these completely unfair cuts are made to northern locations such as ours, and you compare them with what was reported in the press only a few days ago, where Andrew Eagle drew attention to the fact that our cuts are almost the same amount as the extra money that's been given to some of the areas in the south and the Red London, which return Conservative MPs. It does rather make you wonder what our Conservative councillors on Wirral are doing when they ought to be shouting very loudly at their government for the disparity between the north and the south, and between Tory areas and Labour areas. Because all of those Tory voters in Wirral are suffering the results of the Tory government's cuts, with barely a squeak of protest from our councillors, our Tory councillors. I endorse your comments, Chair. I'd only add that I think the Conservative councillors on Wirral ought to be ashamed for their silence.
Okay, thanks, Adrian. Any other comments? Bernie?
The previous item as well, is the knock-on effects of what the government are doing are creating more and more poor people, which means it's going to create more and more people looking for our services with less and less and less money, and it's going to be more and more difficult for us to support the most vulnerable people in society. And we're going into a situation where we're going to have to determine and maybe re-establish what is meant by vulnerable, and that's because of the cruelty of what's going on. So I do think what Adrian's just said is really important, but it's important for us as well as a council, because the stresses and strains that are being put on all departments, it doesn't matter where you are, all departments are feeling the stresses and strains of this. And some of the announcements that he's made this week about finding another 20 billion means that we've got more cuts on the road, and we can't just carry on outsourcing everything. You know, something's got to get somewhere, but I do think we need to be aware, and the public needs to be aware, exactly how severe things are becoming and how tight things are becoming.
Okay, I think, I'd echo all those comments. We do face a really challenging financial process. I think, however, having said that, this administration is determined to continue to deliver good quality frontline services. And I think this report will enable us to do that. So you've heard the recommendations from Tony, are they agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, I at this point will vacate the chair because we're on to item 5 and and I will turn over to Patrick.
Attached as a in Appendix 2 to this report is formally designated as a statutory neighbourhood area for Birkenhead and Tranmere. And we've had a document setting out the decision to refuse the neighbourhood area application and a statement of the council's reason for refusal, together with the council's reason for making the decision to designate an area smaller than was applied for, are published in accordance with Regulation 7 of the Neighbourhood Planning, in brackets General Regulation 2012, and Section 61G of the Town and Country Planning Act 1990, as amended, in consultation with the cabinet member as myself for the economy. And three, that the Birkenhead and Tranmere Neighbourhood Planning Forum is asked to confirm that it is still willing to act in relation to the smaller area, and to confirm that it is able to meet the conditions for designation set out in Section 61F of the Town and Country Planning Act 1990, as amended, before the council agrees before being designated as the statutory neighbourhood planning forum for the smaller neighbourhood area of Birkenhead and Tranmere. And finally, four, recommendation four, that subject to a positive response pursuant to recommendation three, the application for the neighbourhood forum is reported back to cabinet to allow the designation of the neighbourhood forum to be confirmed. Finally, the reason for the recommendation is to fulfil the council's statutory duty for the administration of an application to establish a statutory neighbourhood planning forum and a statutory neighbourhood planning area boundary for Tranmere and Birkenhead. That's the recommendation.
Thank you, Pat. Okay, colleagues, any questions, comments? Okay, we've heard the recommendations as set out at 16 in the report, 1 to 4. Colleagues in agreement with those recommendations? Okay, thank you very much. I'll move on to item 6, which is any urgent business. I haven't been notified of any other urgent business, and therefore, I'll call cabinet to the close. Thank you.